Hi friends, good morning all. My name is Dr. Pratap. Today we are going to start one of the important topic in central nervous system, that is the brainstem syndromes. So before going into the topic proper, in order to have a good comprehension on the subject, let us first discuss something about the anatomy of the brainstem. So the brainstem is grossly divided into three important structures, that is the midbrain, pons and the medulla. For our understanding's sake, let us divide this midbrain, pons and medulla into medial portion and the lateral portion. So the medial portion and the lateral portion. What are the important structures that are present in the medial portion? What are the structures that are present in the lateral portion? If you know about this anatomy, it is very easy to understand the topic proper. So coming to the midbrain, the structures that are present in the medial portion are, number one is the third cranial nerve nuclei. Next, the fibers that are descending from the cerebral cortex through the midbrain into the spinal cord. The very important structures are the pyramidal tracts. Again, there are pyramidal tracts. In the lateral portion of the midbrain, there is another cranial nerve nuclei called as fourth cranial nerve nucleus. The lateralmost portion of the midbrain connects to the cerebellum with a structure that is called as superior cerebellar peduncle. So the importance of this fourth cranial nerve nucleus is it supplies the superior oblique nerve, superior oblique muscle. So superior oblique muscle is supplied by fourth cranial nerve nucleus. So this fourth cranial nerve nucleus forms the vertical gate center. So the fourth cranial nerve nuclei, it forms the vertical gate center. And coming to the anatomy of the pons, in the medial portion of the pons, there is sixth cranial nerve nuclei. Again, the pyramidal tracts that are descending from the midbrain, they are descending through the pons into the medulla. The seventh cranial nerve nucleus is situated in the lateral portion of this pons, which hooks around the sixth cranial nerve nucleus. In the lateral portion of the pons, again there are nuclei related to the fifth cranial nerve nuclei. Going in detail about the fifth cranial nerve nucleus. So it has got four important nuclei. Again, the fifth cranial nerve nucleus has got four important cranial nerve nuclei. They are, number one, the motor nucleus. Number two, the sensory or the principal sensory nucleus. Number three, the descending spinal nuclei. Number four, mesencephalic nucleus. So this motor nucleus, sensory nucleus and the mesencephalic nucleus, these three are situated in the lateral portion of the pons. Whereas the descending spinal nucleus, it descends from the pons through the medulla, it descends into the spinal cord to the level of C3, C4 and then it ascends back into the central nervous or into the brain. So the fifth cranial nerve nucleus, it is again divided into motor nucleus, sensory nucleus, mesencephalic nucleus and the descending tract of spinal nucleus. So what are the other structures that are present in the lateral portion of the pons? The very important structure being the lateral spinothalamic tracts, which are ascending from the spinal cord through the medulla, pons, midbrain into the thalamus. So the lateral spinothalamic nuclei. The lateralmost portion of the pons, which is connecting to the cerebellum, is called as middle cerebellar peduncle. So this forms the brief anatomy of the pons. Coming to the anatomy of the medulla. What is there in the medial part of medulla? nothing but the pyramidal tracts which are descending to the, which are descending from the midbrain through the pons into the medulla. So these are the pyramidal tracts. Then the important cranial nerve nucleus is the 12th cranial nerve nucleus. So the 12th cranial nerve nucleus and the pyramidal tracts are situated in the medial portion of the medulla. What is there in the lateral portion of the medulla? So in the lateral portion of the medulla, rest of the cranial nerve nuclei, the rest of the last four cranial nerve nuclei, that is the 11th cranial nerve nucleus, the 10th cranial nerve nucleus and the 9th cranial nerve nuclei, along with nucleus tractus solitarius and nucleus ambiguus are present. Apart from this, the lateral spinothalamic tracts which are ascending upwards are present in this area. The 5th cranial nerve nucleus, the descending spinal tract is present, which is descending from the pons. Then the vestibular nuclei, two vestibular nuclei are situated in the medulla and two vestibular nuclei are situated in the inferior portion of the pons. So this forms the, and then there is a descending spinal tract, this descending cervical sympathetic chain. So the sympathetic chain descends, this sympathetic chain descends into the cervical canal or into the cervical spinal cord. So these are the important structures or the anatomical parts that are present in the midbrain, pons and the medulla. After discussing about this, let us go in detail into the midbrain syndromes, pontine syndromes and the medullary syndromes. So the first thing, let us start about the midbrain syndromes. So what are the midbrain syndromes? Midbrain syndromes are four in number. Number one, it is Weber syndrome. Number two, Plott syndrome. Number three, Benedict syndrome. Number four, Nutnangel syndrome. So these are the four important brainstem syndromes. Four important midbrain syndromes. So depending upon the portion of medulla, the portion of the brainstem, the midbrain that is involved, whether it is the ventral portion or it is the dorsal portion or it is the complete segment, so depending upon which part of the medulla, which part of the midbrain that is involved, we'll divide this into four important syndromes. First, when the ventral portion of the midbrain is involved, we'll call it as Weber syndrome. When the dorsal portion is involved, there are two important syndromes that are covered under dorsal portion. Number one is Claude's, which is involvement of the inferior segment of the dorsal portion. When the superior segment of the dorsal portion is involved, when the superior segment of dorsal portion is involved or the complete scot is involved, it is called as Nutnangel syndrome. Whereas Benedict syndrome is the combination of Weber syndrome and Claude syndrome. It is, when the features of Weber syndrome and Claude syndrome are present, we will call it as Benedict syndrome. So Weber syndrome, what are the manifestations of Weber syndrome? Weber syndrome involves the third cranial nerve nuclei, third cranial nerve nucleus plus corticospinal tracts. So the third cranial nerve nucleus and the corticospinal tracts are involved in Weber syndrome. So what are the clinical manifestations of patient with Weber syndrome? Because of the involvement of third cranial nerve nucleus, there is ipsilateral third cranial nerve palsy. Then because of the involvement of corticospinal tracts, these corticospinal tracts will descend from the midbrain. In the medulla, they will decussate to the opposite side. That is why there is ipsilateral third nerve palsy with contralateral pyramidal tract involvement. So pyramidal signs, contralateral pyramidal signs or contralateral weakness. So ipsilateral third nerve palsy with contralateral weakness is Weber syndrome. Coming to Claude syndrome. So what is involved in Claude syndrome is, there is involvement of third cranial nerve nucleus plus third cranial nerve, along with this third cranial nerve nucleus, the superior cerebellar peduncle is involved. So what are the clinical manifestations of this involvement? ipsilateral third cranial nerve palsing plus there is ataxia on the same side. Because of involvement of superior cerebellar peduncle, there is ataxia on the same side. What is Benedict? Benedict is nothing but Weber's plus Claude is equal to Benedict syndrome. So there is ipsilateral third nerve palsing along with contralateral weakness, and there is ipsilateral ataxia. This is called as Benedict. What is Nathanael syndrome? Along with the Weber syndrome or along with the features, the extra thing in Nathanael syndrome is involvement of the vertical gate center. What is this vertical gate center? Vertical gate center is nothing but the fourth cranial nerve nucleus. So what is there in this? Whenever there is involvement of the vertical gate center, there is vertical gauge palsy. So vertical gauge palsy, along with all the symptoms that has been discussed above, it is called as Nathanael syndrome. So the syndromes that are involved in midbrain are Weber syndrome, Claude syndrome, Benedict syndrome, Nathanael syndrome. So this is about midbrain syndromes. Then let us move on to the next topic, that is Pontine syndromes. So in Pontine syndromes, again there are four important Pontine syndromes. So what are these Pontine syndromes? Number one, the most common, and maybe this is very common syndrome. So the Pontine syndromes are, number one, is Millard-Dubler syndrome. Number two, Fowlis syndrome. Number three, Raymond-Cistern syndrome. Next, number four, Locked-in syndrome. Again, this is also based upon the which part of the pons is involved, whether it is the ventral pons or the dorsal pons or the complete pons on bilateral sides. When the ventral pons is involved, it is called as Millard-Dubler syndrome. So what are the structures that are involved in Millard-Dubler syndrome? It is again going back to the anatomy. What is there in the ventral pons? There is 6th cranial nerve nucleus, 7th cranial nerve nucleus, and the corticospinal tracts. So what are the presentations when there is involvement of 6th cranial nerve nucleus? There is 6th cranial nerve palsy on the same side, that is ipsilateral 6th cranial nerve palsy. 7th cranial nerve palsy on the same side, ipsilateral 7th cranial nerve palsy. Because of involvement of corticospinal tracts, there is weakness on the opposite side. So contralateral weakness. So this forms the triad of Millard-Dubler syndrome. Ipsilateral 6th nerve palsy, ipsilateral 7th nerve palsy, and the contralateral weakness. So this forms the triad of the Millard-Dubler syndrome. This is involvement of ventral pons. Okay. Then Fowlis syndrome. What about Fowlis syndrome? Fowlis syndrome is involvement of the dorsal pons. In the dorsal pons, again we divide this into medial portion and the lateral portion. So this is involvement of the medial portion of the dorsal pons. The symptoms in this are very similar to that of the Millard-Dubler syndrome. That is, there is involvement of the 6th cranial nerve nucleus, involvement of the 7th cranial nerve nucleus, corticospinal tracts can be involved. Along with this, there is horizontal gaze palsy is present, which is the differentiating feature between a Millard-Dubler syndrome and a Fowlis syndrome. So this horizontal gaze palsy is nothing but the 6th cranial nerve nucleus is considered to be the horizontal gaze center, as like that of 4th cranial nerve nucleus, which is considered as a vertical gaze center. The 6th cranial nerve nucleus is considered as a horizontal gate center. When there is involvement of 6th cranial nerve nucleus extensively, that is involvement of ventral and dorsal, there is loss of this horizontal gauge. So this is called as horizontal gauge palsy. So these are the symptoms of Fowlis syndrome, that is 6th cranial nerve nucleus, that is 6th cranial nerve palsy on the same side, 7th cranial nerve palsy on the same side, weakness on the contralateral side and the horizontal gaze palsy. So what is this Raymond-Easton syndrome? Raymond-Easton syndrome is very similar to lateral medullary syndrome. The lateral medullary syndrome is because of involvement of lateral medulla. Raymond-Easton syndrome is involvement of lateral pons. So this is involvement of the lateral pons, that too on the dorsal aspect. So what are the structures that are involved in the lateral pons? Fifth nerve nucleus. Lateral spinothalamic tracts. Middle cerebellar peduncle. And when there is an extensive involvement, horizontal gaze center can also be involved. So what are the manifestations of involvement of fifth nerve nucleus? Again, the fifth nerve nucleus has got four important components. Number one, it is the motor. Number two is sensory. Number three is spinal tract. Number four, mesencephalic. When there is involvement of motor tract of fifth nerve nucleus, you will get motor paralysis. That is, the muscles of mastication are paralyzed. Sensory part of nucleus is involved. There is sensory loss on the ipsilateral half of the face. Spinal nucleus is involved. There is loss of pain and temperature on the ipsilateral part of the face. When the mesencephalic nucleus is involved, there is loss of jaw jerk. So this is involvement of fifth nerve nucleus. Lateral spinothalamic tract. Whenever there is lateral spinothalamic tract involvement, so where are these lateral spinothalamic tracts coming from? These lateral spinothalamic tracts are actually coming from the opposite half of the body. So these tracts will carry the pain and temperature from the opposite half of the body. So there is contralateral loss of pain and temperature. Contralateral loss of pain and temperature on body, on opposite half of the body. Ipsilateral loss of pain and temperature. Ipsilateral loss of pain and temperature on face. Okay, it is the contralateral loss of pain and temperature on the opposite half of the body with ipsilateral loss of pain and temperature on the same half of the face. Then, when this middle cerebellar peduncle is involved, what are the manifestations? There is ataxia. When the horizontal gaze center is involved, there is loss of horizontal gaze palsy will be there. So, this is about Raymond-Easton syndrome. Then coming to the last one. The last one is called as locked-in syndrome. This is nothing but whenever there is extensive involvement of the basilar artery. That is, when there is a thrombus in the basilar artery or when there is an extensive involvement of the basilar artery, there is bilateral involvement of the pons. When the pons is involved bilaterally, almost every center that is present, almost every nucleus that is present in the pons is gone. Except for the vertical gaze movement is preserved. So only the vertical gaze is preserved. Rest of the movements are lost. Why this vertical gaze is preserved? Because it is present in the midbrain. It is not a function of the pons. So the patient is awake. Patient is awake and he is aware of the surroundings. But is not able to express. There is weakness in all the limbs. That is, patient has got quadriparesis. Only movement that is preserved is the vertical movements of the eyes. The horizontal movements of eyes are lost, vertical movements of the eyes are present. He is able to understand what you are saying, but he is not able to respond to that. So he is in a locked-in state. So this is called as locked-in syndrome. So locked-in syndrome is because of extensive involvement of the basilar pons, basilar artery, leading to involvement of bilateral pons. Because there is bilateral pontine involvement, corticospinal tracts on either side are involved. That is why all the four limbs has gone into paralysis. So that is why the patient has got quadriparesis. So the respiratory center is preserved here because the respiratory center is present in the medulla. That is why the patient is able to take respiration on his own. So this is about the Pontine syndrome. That is the locked-in syndrome. Then moving to the very, very important area, the medulla. So there are only two syndromes in medulla, that is the medial medullary syndrome and the lateral medullary syndrome. Medial medullary syndrome and the lateral medullary syndrome. medial medullary syndrome and the lateral medullary syndrome. So involvement of the medial portion of the medulla, it is called as medial medullary syndrome. So what is there in the medial medulla? There is 12th nerve nucleus and the corticospinal tracts. So the corticospinal tract. So the medial medullary syndrome, what are the manifestations of medial medullary syndrome? There are only two manifestations. There is ipsilateral 12th nerve palsy, ipsilateral 12th nerve palsy, contralateral corticospinal tract involvement. So that is contralateral weakness. So this is very simple. Only the ipsilateral 12th nerve palsy and contralateral weakness. So this forms the medial medullary syndrome. Then the most important thing is the lateral medullary syndrome. The lateral medullary syndrome. So what are the lateral, what are the manifestations of this lateral medullary syndrome? This lateral medullary syndrome has got synonyms. So what are the synonyms of this lateral medullary syndrome? Number one, it is also called as Pica syndrome. This is also called as Pica syndrome. So Pica means posterior inferior cerebellar artery. Posterior inferior cerebellar artery. Number two, so the other name is called as Wallenberg syndrome. Wallenberg syndrome. So the synonyms is asked as a bit, it is asked as an MCQ. Then Wallenberg syndrome and posterior inferior cerebellar artery syndrome. So the most common artery that is involved in lateral medullary syndrome, this has been repeatedly asked as a question. So what is the most common artery that is involved in lateral medullary syndrome? So is it the vertebral artery or the posterior inferior cerebral artery? In spite of getting the name of Pica syndrome, it is not the Pica artery that is the most common artery that is involved. It is the vertebral artery that is most commonly involved. So the incidence is vertebral artery, that to the fourth part of vertebral artery is the most common artery to get involved. Is the most common artery to get involved in a patient with lateral medullary syndrome, followed by posterior inferior cerebellar artery. So it is not the posterior inferior cerebellar artery, it is the vertebral artery. So what are the structures that are present in the lateral medulla then? So what are the structures that are present in the lateral medulla? 11th cranial nerve nucleus, 10th cranial nerve nucleus, 9th cranial nerve nucleus, nucleus tractus solitarius, lateral spinothalamic tracts. So these are the ascending fibers. Lateral spinothalamic tracts are actually the ascending fibers. Inferior cerebellar pedunculi. The lateral most portion is the inferior cerebellar pedunculi. Then comes the descending tract of 5th cranial nerve nucleus, that is the spinal nucleus of 5th cranial nerve nucleus. Descending tract of spinal tract, descending spinal tract of 5th cranial nerve nucleus. Then the sympathetic chain, sympathetic chain. Then hiccup center, hiccup center. Two vestibular nuclei, vestibular nuclei. So these are the structures that are present in the lateral most portion of the medulla. So these are the structures that are got, that are involved in the lateral medullary syndrome. So depending upon the involvement, so whenever there is involvement of 9th cranial nerve nucleus and the 10th cranial nerve nucleus, the patient will have ipsilateral dysphagia, ipsilateral dysphagia, ipsilateral dysphonia, nasal regurgitation of fluids, nasal regurgitation of fluids. Then involvement of the 11th cranial nerve on the same side, the patient will get ipsilateral weakness of sternocleidomastoid and trapeziusmuscle. So these two are the muscles that are supplied by the 11th cranial nerve nuclei or the 11th nerve. Then involvement of the lateral spinothalamic tracts. When the lateral spinothalamic tracts are involved, so these lateral spinothalamic tracts are carrying the sensation, that is the pain and temperature sensation, from the opposite half of the body. So there is contralateral loss of pain and temperature, contralateral loss of pain and temperature in the up in the body. Then fifth nerve nucleus, that is the spinal descending tract. So this spinal descending tract will carry only two sensations, that is pain and temperature. The principal sensory nucleus will carry all of the rest of the sensations, that is pain and temperature are only the sensations that are carried by this descending spinal tract. All other sensations like vibration, touch, proprioception, every other modality of sensation, they are being carried by the sensory nucleus, principal sensory nucleus, which is present in the upwards, that is in the palms. So there is loss of ipsilateral, loss of pain and temperature on face. Next, whenever there is involvement of the sympathetic chain, when there is involvement of sympathetic chain, there is ipsilateral Horner syndrome. So what are the components of Horner syndrome? This is again a bit. So what are the components of Horner syndrome? There are four components of Horner syndrome: meiosis, ptosis, anhydrosis, and loss of ciliospinal reflex. And one more thing is anophthalmos. So these are the components of the Horner syndrome. So there is a partial ptosis, there is meiosis, there is anhydrosis, there is anophthalmosis, and there is loss of ciliospinal reflex. So because of the involvement of hiccup center, there is recurrent hiccups. So the patient has got uncontrolled hiccups. Then involvement of the inferior cerebellar peduncle. When there is an involvement of inferior cerebellar peduncle, patient will get ataxia and all other cerebellar symptoms. So then when there is involvement of vestibular nucleus, again the patient has got ataxia, dizziness, giddiness, and so on. So these are the important manifestations of a patient with lateral medullary syndrome. So then what are the etiologies of these brainstem syndromes? Majority of the times the etiology is vascular. So depending upon the branches that are involved, so you should know something about the types of branches that are present in the posterior circulation. So what is posterior circulation? Posterior circulation is nothing but the branches that are coming from the vertebral artery. So there are two vertebral arteries. So these two vertebral arteries, they will join and form a basilar artery. So this basilar artery is present in the middlemost portion of the brainstem. So this basilar artery has got two types of very, very important branches. Number one, the first important branch is called as median or the paramedian branches. So what is meant by median or paramedian? These are nothing but very short branches. They are situated only in the middlemost portion, that is the medianmost portion. The number two, these are the long circumferential branches. They are nothing but, these are very long branches. They arise from the basilar artery. They will be going very laterally and supplying the lateralmost portions of the palms or the medulla or the brainstem. So depending upon what is the type of branch that is involved, you will get a medial medullary syndrome or the lateral medullary syndrome, and medial pontine syndrome, lateral pontine syndrome. So what are the branches of this, basilar artery? There are five important branches of basilar artery. Number one is the pontine artery, labyrinthine artery, the end artery, that is the posterior cerebral artery, posterior cerebral artery. There are two more branches.